الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وكفى والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن سن سنته واهتدى بهديه إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون بالبينات والزبر، صدق الله العظيم. So my dear and respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So my dear brothers and sisters, as I was telling you last night, that in 14th Juz, there is a surah called Suratul Hijr. And after that comes Surah An-Nahl. So in 14th Juz, there are only two surahs, Surah Al-Hijr and Surah An-Nahl. Now, An-Nahl means the bee. And as I told you last night, that Surah An-Nahl, the bee, is a surah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is counting and then explaining different signs of His greatness. From animals to birds to insects to the skies and the mountain, everything that Allah subhanahu has created, Allah subhanahu is counting them for us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that if you think how these things were created and how these things are running without the help from any human being, you will see the sign of Allah's greatness in that. Now in the same surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala further on said that فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, that O people, and learn ilm, learn the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, learn the knowledge of Quran, learn the knowledge of hadith, but make sure that you learn the knowledge of Quran and hadith from those individuals who possess that knowledge. So Allah is saying, do not go to those people who themselves are ignorant about the true knowledge, because if you'll go to them, they are going to take you away from the right path. So if you look into this ayah, Allah said, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ. Ask, meaning seek knowledge from أَهْلُ الذِّكْرِ. أَهْلُ الذِّكْرِ means people who have knowledge and they have the right kind of knowledge. They have learned the knowledge of Quran and Hadith from the right sources. They are called أَهْلُ الذِّكْرِ or أَهْلُ الْعِلْمِ. So, my dear brothers and sisters, I would like to make you understand this point very well. Why? Because we are fast approaching the last day of this world. Or the day of judgment is coming very fast. And among the signs of the day of judgment, Rasulullah ﷺ mentioned in one hadith that people, اتخذوا الناس جهالا, people will take ignorant people as their teacher. Okay, so people will take ignorant people as their teachers, and yastaftun fayuftun, that people will ask Islamic related matters to them, to these ignorant people. And these ignorant people will answer their questions. So then Rasulullah said that these people who are asking these ignorant people, they are going to be misled. Why? Because the person whom they are asking this question, he was not competent, he was not qualified, he should not have answered these questions. So Rasulullah said that this is one of the signs of the day of judgment. And so this is in hadith, a sahih hadith. And my dear brothers and sisters, as I said, the signs of the day of judgment are so evident. This sign is also very evident. That people are going to mislead people by claiming that come and learn from me because I possess the knowledge of Quran and Hadith, although they are not qualified, although they are not capable of interpreting Quran and Hadith, but they will, you know, they will be misleading people like this, and the number of such people will keep on growing. So you will come across people who literally not only just secretly but openly will go against the clear ayat of Quran and Ahadith. And most alarmingly, people who are listening to them, they will believe in them. And they will think that all our ancestors were wrong and nobody had understood Islam. All of these generations of ulamas and fuqahad and muhaddithin, and although they were all wrong, nobody had learned, have understood Quran and Hadith. Today finally this man or these men have understood Quran and Hadith. So they will be misleading and people will be misled. Now Rasulullah said that when you see this, this is a clear sign of the Day of Judgment. So my dear brothers and sisters, we have to first know whom are we learning Quran Hadith from. You see, just like brothers, you know, if you go to a doctor, you know, and that doctor has never been to a medical school, and he claims that, you know, I'm a MD and, no, sorry, I'm a medical doctor. I don't have MDs, you know, to go to a medical school is a medieval thing, outdated thing. It is like once upon a time thing. You know, this is a new world, technology on internet, everything is available. I'm a doctor, I claim to be a medical doctor, I can perform surgery, you know, I can prescribe medicine, I can see patients because everything is available on Google. So there's no need to go to medical college and waste your time there. You see? So brothers, you know, no insurance is going to cover this doctor. And if you go to such a doctor, may Allah protect your life. You see? In the same way, brother, when it comes to ilm of deen, there are colleges, Islamic seminaries, that are called Madaris and Darul Ulooms. Since 1400 years, this tradition has been going and continuing. That if you want to become a scholar, if you want to become an alim or a mufti, if you want to give fatwas, if you want to learn Quran Hadith, so you have to go to the Islamic seminaries. And you have to follow the curriculum. And then you cannot call yourself an authority on Islam till you have been given the ijaza by those people who are people of authority. You see? So this is a centuries old tradition, and this is how in every science, not only this Islamic knowledge, but in every branch of knowledge, whether it's medicine or whatever, you engineering or whatever it is, you know, the same pattern is followed. You know, so, and the Islamic knowledge is the most sacred one among all. Because al-ayadu billah, if you go to a wrong doctor, person who is not a doctor, he gave you a medicine, and al-ayadu billah, if you leave this world, you know, what happened was that you lost your life, that's it. But at least in the life hereafter, you know, if your aqeedah was right, inshallah, you'll be saved from hell. But al-ayadu billah, if you go to a wrong person who claims to be an authority, and he's not. He never went to any Islamic seminary. He had never got any ijaza. Now you started going there, you al-ayadu billah might end up losing your aqeedah, losing your belief. That is more damaging than losing your life. Because your aqeedah is what matters the most. So one of our great ancestors in the very second century, Imam Ibn Uyayna rahimahullah said that, "O people, learning, ilm is deen. Learning, ilm is deen. So be very watchful from whom you are learning. From whom you are learning. You know." So I'm warning you, brothers. These days there are like so many so-called or self-proclaimed authorities on Quran and Hadith, and you know such people. What they do is, in order to get attention from people, what they do is that they come across some such, you know, bizarre explanation of Quran and Hadith. That when people hear, they say, "Oh, hello, I never heard that. Who said that? Oh, that person said that. Oh, let me listen to him." So this way these people attract, because if they are saying the same thing which Allah Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam have said, Sahaba Tami have said, the people will not be alarmed. "Oh yes, we have been hearing this, yes." But they go against the majority. Now people say, "Oh well, we need this person. This person is giving us so much, you know, such new aqaid which, you know, nobody had given before." So in the same way, so I'd like to point to you one ayah of Quran, which is, since it's an ayah of Quran, my dear brother and sister, is a part of aqidah. So before I translate this ayah, which is I think well known to all of you, but remember that the aqidah of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, meaning Muslims, is that if a person refuses to believe in a single ayah of Quran, he's out of the fold of Islam. Or if a person says, "Well, I believe in the ayah but not the meaning of the ayah," see, that person is out of the fold of Islam. See? So, one ayah, brother, is the first ayah of Surah Bani Israel. Isra. Now, the word Isra means night travel. Mi'raj means ascension to heaven. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Allah gave this honor to our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of traveling on the back of this animal of Jannah called Al-Burraq from Makkah to Jerusalem one night, and then from Jerusalem after praying Salah in Masjid Al-Aqsa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought him alive into the heaven, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought him back to Jerusalem and then to Makkah. Now this is something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored our Rasulullah sallam with. It was not a dream, because if it was a dream, so everybody sees a dream, so what's so unique about it? But since Rasulullah ﷺ went physically, so Allah Himself mentioned this extraordinary event in a very glorifying words. Allah subhanahu, the first ayah of Bani Israel, Surah Bani Israel. Allah says, "Subhanalladhi أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياته." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is the most exalted, who took his slave, meaning Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Masjid al-Haram, meaning from Makkah to Jerusalem, إلى المسجد الأقصى. Allah said, الذي باركنا حوله. Allah is the one who had blessed the land of Philistine, the land of Masjid al-Aqsa, in different ways. Allah said, "Linuriyahu min ayatina." Allah said, "I took my abd, Rasulullah sallam, so I can show him." Brother, look at this. "I can show him the signs of my greatness." So it was not a dream. If it was a dream, brother, you can understand Allah would not have used these words. I mean, common sense. But some people who are not qualified, they are self-claimed authority on Quran, they with such shamelessness come on television and go on speaking about this ayah saying that this is nothing but a myth. Wallahi brothers, that's what they say. There's nothing but a myth. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not go to Isra and Mi'raj. It was a dream that Rasulullah saw. So my dear brothers and sisters, leave those people alone. Just leave them alone. Sorry to say this, but they are completely crazy people. Because here is an ayah of Quran so evident, so clear. Now we are not going to hadith yet, because there are hundreds of hadith that talk about Isra and Mi'raj. Hundreds of sahih hadith in Bukhari, Muslim and other book of ahadith. I'm just talking about the ayah of Quran. So Allah said, "Innahu huwa Sami'ul Basir." And then in Surah An-Najm, in the 26th juz, 27th juz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about the incident of Mi'raj in great details. So what I'm saying, brother, is that I'm not going to go into the detail of Isra and Mi'raj right now, but my point here, brother, is that as we are getting closer and closer to the last days of this world, most important thing is, brother, safeguard your iman. There are so many thieves and robbers out there who are ready to steal your iman from you. And you would think that no, this person is right, and your iman would be gone. Completely gone. See? So whom you are following? Who is the person from whom you are learning Quran and Hadith? This is more important than checking the credentials of your doctor. Iman is the most important thing, the most precious thing. Do not lose it. So, first ayah of Bani Israel is talking about Isra and Mi'raj. So I will repeat one more time, my dear brothers and sisters, that Isra and Mi'raj happened to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam physically, not just dream. Rasulullah went physically to Isra and Mi'raj. This is in Quran, and hundreds of ahadith, brothers and sisters, are explaining this incident. Hundreds of them. So this should be your belief. You believe in Quran, brothers, believe in it. This is the right belief. Anybody who says contrary to it, do not listen. Or if you listen, don't believe in him. He is there to steal your iman and give you something else in its place. So Surah Bani Israel, my dear brothers and sisters, is in 15th juz. Now Surah Bani Israel is another beautiful surah of Quran. In the last 10 minutes, let me talk to you about one or two ayahs of Surah Bani Israel. If you read Surah Bani Israel, 13, 14, I think 15th ayah or 16th ayah of this surah talks about the day of Hashr. And whether Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this ayah, small ayah, but it's an eye-opener, literally eye-opener. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَكُلَّ إِنسَانٍ أَلْزَمْنَاهُ طَائِرَهُ فِي عُنُقِهِ وَنُخْرِجُ لَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كِتَابًا يَلْقَاهُ مَنْشُورًا اقرأ كتابك كَفَى بِنَفْسِكَ الْيَوْمَ عَلَيْكَ حَسِيبًا. Allah said, وَكُلَّ إِنسَانٍ, in the neck of every human being, I have put something which Allah have called ta'ir. Allah knows best what is the meaning of ta'ir. Nowadays, brother, you can use our term like a chip. And Allah said that this chip or ta'ir is documenting and recording each and every actions plus each and every thought of yours. Thoughts which has not been transformed into words by you. These are just thoughts. You are thinking about something evil. You're not giving that those thoughts your words. But Allah is saying this ta'ir, this chip, is documenting each and every action, word, plus your thoughts. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that this thing is such that it is not leaving a single thing alone. Everything is being recorded. Now we do not know. If you look at our neck, you know, doctors can go and you know, they can look and say, well, there's no ta'ir here. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying it's invisible. Just like your ruh is invisible, you know, nobody can see your ruh, but you feel it. You are alive because the ruh in your soul. Similarly, ta'ir is something invisible. But Allah is saying you cannot see it, it is right there. And it is documenting each and everything. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that it is such a powerful thing that Allah had created in our neck. That وَنُخْرِجُ لَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كِتَابًا. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment will take this ta'ir out of our neck and it will become a kitab. It will become a kitab manshura. Open. You know? Just like whether you have a small chip and you print it. You know, you see hundreds of pages are coming out from a small chip. Now, we have these examples to give to you. But Sahaba who were living as Bedouins, they didn't have access to all this. But they believed in Rasulullah Sallam. They believe in the Quran. And Allah said, when I will get the print out of this ta'ir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Iqra kitabak. Iqra, you read your own book of deeds. No need for me to take hisab and kitab of you. But iqra kitabak, you read your own book of deed and then you do your own hisab and kitab. Kafa binafsikal yawma alayka, you become your own auditor. Audit your own deeds. Allah is saying, I'm not going to do it, you do it. All the evidence are in front of you. The book is there. You see each and everything is documented. Now you do your own audit. My dear brothers and sisters, then let's move on to Surah Kahf. In Surah Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about this ta'ir again. The ayah is Mali hadal kitab. Mali hadal kitab. La yugadiru saghiratan wala kabiratan illa ahsaha. Allah saying, when this print out would be given to you, you will look from the time of your birth till the last breath. All the actions, everything that you had done has been mentioned and documented in that. So you will say, Mali hadal kitab, what kind of a book is this? La yughadir saghira, it had not left a small act, wala kabira, nor a big act, illa but ahsaha, it had been documented in this. Allah said, wabajadu ma amilu hadira, whatever you had done in this world will become obvious to you. وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. And remember that your Rabb never does zulm. He never oppresses anybody. You know, this is going to happen to each one of us on the day of judgment. You see? Yes. Some fortunate people among us, you know, Allah will not take their chip out, ta'ir. Allah will leave that ta'ir here. Allah will say, you know, Ya Allah, go. Without hisab kitab, go to Jannah. So your ta'ir will be here. It will not be taken out. Because once it is taken out, there nobody can fulfill the standards set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one hadith sharif says, aaj bahut baatein honi bhai. Rasulullah said that if you are stopped and ask questions, then you are doomed. So if your chip is taken out and you are handed the printout, Rasulullah said that you are doomed, you are gone. So make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, you know, you are not stopped. You know, like when you come from overseas through customs, you know, you just go through the green channel. You know, nobody stops you. Because if you are going from the red channel, and if you are stopped and you are searched, and you are coming from India, Pakistan especially, there are so many things that you are not allowed to come, bring in. So from green channel, if you are going through green channel, you are not stopped. Alhamdulillah. Similarly, if you are stopped on the day of judgment, ask question. So my dear brother and sister, nobody will come clean except for Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. But my dear brother and sister, everything is being documented. And as I have mentioned to you earlier about Luqman alayhi salatu wasalam, I think yesterday, 2 days ago, we read this surah Luqman. Luqman was not a prophet. He was a wise man. He's called Luqman Hakim. He was not a prophet, a wise man. So he used to talk to people in such a way that due to his wisdom, people will remember his advices for a long time. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself documented some of his advices in Quran. And Allah named the surah Luqman. About Luqman, brother, it has come that when he was dying, breathing his last breath, he had several children. So his children were next to him. And now Luqman is leaving, and he was always concerned about his children's iman. Because if you read Surah Luqman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِذُهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ. Allah said that Luqman used to teach his children Tawheed. And he used to say to his children, even when his children are grown up, they are adults themselves. But he used to say, my children, remember, never do shirk with Allah. So Luqman is leaving. His children are next to his deathbed. And before leaving, he wanted to give one last piece of advice. So he opened his eyes. He was sick. He was weak. He looked at his children. His children were crying. He said to his children, my dear children, your dad is leaving. Your dad is leaving never to come back. Because a person who leaves never comes back. So I will meet you on the day of Hashr, inshallah. But as I'm leaving, my dear children, I'm going to give you one last advice. So his children, you know, they gave full attention, of course, to their dad's last advice. So Luqman alayhi salatu wasalam said, my children, all my life I have been telling you not to disobey Allah, follow Allah. Now I'm dying and I'm telling you that go ahead and disobey Allah. Go ahead and disobey Allah after my death. So his children were like, what? He said, yes, my dear children. But each time you decide to disobey Allah, try to find a spot in this world to do that sinful act which is hidden from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see that wisdom? He took a different approach. And he said, try to find a spot to disobey Allah which is hidden from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear children, if you can find such a spot in the world, go ahead and disobey him. You see? Why? Because everything is being washed over by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear brothers and sisters, this ayah, اِقْرَأْ كِتَابَكْ. One more time I'd like to remind you that this ta'ira is documenting everything. Everything is being documented. Secondly, brothers, every spot where you are doing different actions, every spot is documenting. إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَالَهَا وَأَخْرَجَتِ الْأَرْضُ أَثْقَالَهَا وَقَالَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا لَهَا يَوْمَئِذٍ تُحَدِّثُ أَخْبَارَهَا. On that day, the earth will speak. This is why, brother, let's say you prayed Isha Salah at this spot. Now, in order to pray Sunnah and Nafil Salah, it is mustahab to take one step or, you know, a little bit here, back, forth. Why? Why is that? Because different places where you'll make sajda, those spots will testify in your favor. That this person had done, let's say, 100 sajda on me. So this is why it is recommended to do so. Not today, brother, because the jamaat is too much. Don't do it today, otherwise. But you know, when the jamaat is small, then. So earth is documenting, the ta'ira is documenting, plus kiraman katibin. The angels are documenting. You know, so then on the fourth thing is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the organs that you use to disobey Allah, your organs that you use to disobey Allah on the day of Hashr, those organs will also testify against you. Like we read in Surah Yasin last night, Al-Yawma Nakhtimu ala afwahihim wa tukallimuna aydihim wa tashhadu arjuluhum bima kanu. Allah said on this day, the day of Hashr, I will seal your mouth, you will not be able to speak a word. In this world you have been speaking all your life. On the day of Hashr, no, you cannot speak, Allah will seal your mouth. But Allah said, your hands, your legs, and your body parts will testify whether you had done good deeds or bad deeds. So though that day, brother, is coming, and in this nights of Ramadan and days of Ramadan, brother, we should prepare for that day. Quran, whether Surah Isra or Surah Najm or other surahs, are reminding us about these facts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help you and me understand this. Subhanallah, bihamdi, subhanakallah, bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta.